Hello, namaste. I'm back here with the lecture 4, where we would be understanding how do we represent a real world in terms of surface model. I was speaking about different surface models that are existent. We'll look at what are different types of surface model and how will we actually define this. So there are various ways, various definitions of the surface model. We'll look at each of the surface model in this particular lecture. Why this is extremely important is that, for example, when if you are trying to model any land surfaces, the first thing that you have to generate is a surface model. So that is how you understand how you what is a kind of earth surface you have. Okay, so any kind of analysis, any kind of GIS analysis, the first thing you generate is a surface model. So let's look at different surface model, and in this in today's class, I would be defining what you mean by a surface representation. Then we would look at what is a digital terrain model, what is a digital surface model and a digital elevation model. How do you actually generate this? Then you have a grid model. So we'll look at all of these things in this particular class. So let's go into every one of these and understand different ways of representation. The first thing is surface representation. When I say surface, surface is not represented only by an x and y dimension. Okay, why? Because when you have x and y dimension, it is just a planimetric location, but surface should always involve a z location, which means a z dimension, which is actually giving a height, elevation and magnitude. So in addition to the x y coordinates, so if you have only x y, then it becomes planimetric and extremely difficult to represent a surface. Okay, so when you are looking at a digital representation of any terrain surface, it's called a digital terrain model. Okay, or very frequently called as DTMs or digital elevation model. Okay, so digital elevation model comprises various arrangements of individual points. Okay, please understand this. Digital elevation model comprises various arrangements of individual points in x, y and z coordinates. So if it is only x, y, then it's planimetric, whereas if you have z coordinate, then it becomes a surface. Okay, because it's giving height, elevation or a magnitude. Then our terrain models are computed by linking heights as an attribute to each points. Okay, always remember this. This is extremely important when people are trying to represent a surface. So they don't understand that we have x1, x, y and z. What students do is that you take a image, you just try to represent a DM and say this is a DM. So you don't understand what do you mean by an x, y and how you represent a z. So you have different tools, you just develop it, but always remember it always has a third dimension. And representing a third dimension is extremely important when you are doing any surface analysis. Okay, so when you say a digital terrain model, okay, the model which is able to take only one z value, so it can have number of z values at a point of time, but there is, if it can take only one z value, it is termed as a 2.5 dimensional model and is oftenly called as a digital terrain model. Okay, please understand, a model which is able to take only one z value, that is the crux. One z value, it's called a 2.5D model. Okay, see, for example, you have x, y and one z, then it's called a 2.5D model. Here when you look at this one surface, it is like this. Okay, when you are representing this particular region, you have x and y along with it, you know what is the geographical location of this place, and then you have a z value, that is the height of this place. Okay, you have only one value at that point, then it is called a 2.5D model. Okay, now if there is elevation, that is the integral part of any model. So you have one elevation, you have second elevation, you have third elevation in the same region. So number of values of x of z1, z2, z3. So this is along with the xy pair is called a 3D model, okay, normally referred to as digital elevation model. If this, if you have a 2.5D model, then it is a digital terrain model, whereas you have a 3D model, it is normally referred to as a digital elevation model. When to give you an example of digital terrain models, digital terrain models describe the terrain numerically in the form of x, y and z coordinates, and you have only one z coordinate. For if it is a graphic representation, can be either in the form of a grid or even a profile, okay. That is how a digital terrain model is represented. This is an image that is sourced from Acrometrix. So, you can, this is a digital terrain model of the earth surface. You can see the terrain, how this terrain is divided. You can see where there is actually a slope and where there is an high terrain in this particular image. And there is again, there is another notion called as surface, digital surface model. So, what this is basically, it is nothing different from a terrain model, but it is actually giving you the surface, describes a terrain surface including the above ground objects. So, for example, let us say someone wants to be, understand what is the height of a building. So, the first thing you develop is a DTM, you define a digital terrain model, okay, then add surface information to it, okay. So, which means that you will give numerically the above ground objects into the x, y, z coordinates, okay. So, that becomes a surface terrain, a surface model, digital surface model or digital surface terrain model, okay. Which means you can see here there is a terrain, the same image, there is a terrain information also here, okay. There is a surface information of buildings, roads, etc., right. So, that is what is called a digital surface model. Now, I hope everyone understands what is the difference between a surface model and a terrain model, okay. Now, if to give you more precise information, this is what is nothing but a digital surface and this is nothing but a digital, digital terrain and this is nothing but a digital surface. So, if you look at an exclusive representation of that, this is a surface, if this is there, this is just a surface of the earth, so it is called a terrain, okay. If you add information about a building, road, etc., then this value comes here on the terrain, then it is called a digital surface model, okay. So, normally a digital elevation model is a generic term with for both DTM and DEM, okay. Only thing is that digital terrain model has a single z value, whereas digital elevation model at every point can have more than one z values, okay. That you should remember, that is a difference, basic difference between a DTM and DEM, but in general both are referring to the same kind of representation. So, the next thing is a grid model. Grid is a regular space set of points which with which something associated, for example, you have a field values defined as intersection of perpendicular grid lines. If for example, in this particular image, if you add grid lines, you have perpendicular nodes, okay, which has certain specific values, okay. These intersection nodes has certain specific values. This is nothing called, this is called as a grid model. A grid defines a geographic space as a matrix of identically sized square cells. So, whenever you are looking at a grid, these are large number of identically sized square cells. Any it can be any number of cells, but these are identically sized. So, that you should keep in mind, grids cannot have different values, but these are identically spaced. It differs from a raster, the associated value represent a point values, not the cell values. So, grid model is not a raster model, okay. Grid model is not, it has a data as a point data about what you are representing from the real world. The elevation is assumed to be constant within each cell of a grid always, that is how the grid is built. So, once you build a grid, that particular z value will remain constant. Grid size is constant in a model, so areas with greater variations of terrain may be described in a less accurate way. Otherwise, you will not be able to exactly say what kind of differentiation is this. So, in a way that you are approximating anything that is falling into the grid into a particular z value. That is why it is less accurate in terms of representation of any terrain information. Always grid model is avoided in terms of representing any terrain values, any z values if you are trying to represent any different quantities. But the main concern here is to understand how a terrain model can be used, how a surface model can be used. So, let me go back to the terrain model and the surface model here. Because when I normally speak to students, they assume that the terrain model and the surface model they have understood, but please understand it is not so easy to really get into a terrain model or a surface model. You have the generation of terrain model and surface model is extremely difficult in terms of extraction of the z values. So, I would suggest if anyone who is learning this particular subject, if you want to generate a DEM or a DTM and also the surface model, do not just go into a software and put in your data and generate whatever the output is there and say I already have a DEM or a DSM. But please understand you need to have values from the ground which accurately measures, not whatever the DEM you generated from the satellite data have accuracy measures also. So, you should look at what is the kind of accuracy and what kind of measurements you are trying to do. Otherwise, it is giving you imprecise measurements on your earth surface. So, if you then measurements made on your planimetric data and your digitally elevated data, you may not match in terms of the real world quantities. So, please keep in mind that you have to look at what is the error associated with generating a DEM or a DSM and then verify it on the ground to correct it. Correct it to the real world scenario, without which it is going to fail in a larger context. Okay. So, that is about a digital elevation model and a digital surface model, but as I said grid model is least used because it is least accurate in terms and has extremely less variation in terms of what it has to be. But you have certain advantages that are associated with it. Let me give you certain, before I get into advantages, let me give an example of a grid model. For example, you have a raster here, okay, this is a raster data. So, now raster data has various values, this is an water body, this is a city, etcetera, okay. Now, if I zoom into this particular region, okay, this is an individual cell here, okay. This, when I see here, is a collection of maybe a number of points, a number of values. So, it is giving only one value at that particular entire location. If let us say this entire cell is representing 1 kilometer 1 by 1 kilometer grid or 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer location on the ground, which means it is representing a single elevation value across 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer. That is why a grid model is normally avoided in terms of using in terms of representation of any of the surfaces. But there are certain advantages when you are looking at a grid model. It is simple conceptual model, very simple. You are just converting those points on the map to grids and each grid has a value and representation of that value is extremely easy. Because you have different values associated with different grids, just give a range of values a particular color, so representation is extremely easy, the thematic representation is extremely easy. So, data is cheap to obtain, yeah, this the kind of data that you need is extremely cheap to obtain and cheap to generate, easy to generate, okay, easy to relate to other raster data. So, once you have a grid, it is easier to relate any raster data with can be easily associated with it. Then irregularly spaced set of points can be converted to regular spaces just by interpolations using an interpolation technique. Any kind of interpolation technique you can convert into the equally spaced or regular spaced values. So, that is what about the grid model. Okay. So, but when we look at disadvantages, this does not conform to variability on terrain. I have explained how the variability of terrain cannot be captured using a grid model. Then linear features is not well represented, or it is hardly represented in a grid model. The grid model is more suitable for describing random variations in the terrain, while the systematic linear structures can be easily disappear or be deformed. So, I have shown you how do you convert a vector to a raster, and when a road is represented in a raster, it is quite deformed in terms of representation. You do not understand what kind of representation it is. So, that is why the grid model is extremely disadvantageous in terms of usage. So, this is about the grid model. So, when you look at the entire chapter here, we spoke about the surface representation, how do we represent a surface. We looked at the digital terrain model. Terrain model, you have a z value that defines a digital terrain model. When you have a surface related to it, so you add features on the surface to it, then it becomes a digital surface model. Then you have, when we looked at how a digital elevation model is useful, number of z coordinates encoded, then you have a grid model which is actually giving you gridded values of the same space. So, if you have elevation values in the grid, so it gives only single elevation values for the entire grid. So, it is extremely disadvantageous. So, in the next session, we will also discuss more about certain different kinds of models, but as of now, the very important part that both of us have to do is that the first thing is when we take up probably hands on in using QGIS, we will try to generate the digital elevation model of a particular place, so that we understand how you represent elevation as a 3D space. Okay. Then the very important thing that I would request most of you guys to look at is go back and try to read some of the textbooks that I have mentioned earlier, and understand how the surface representation is important and how your DEM or DTM is extremely capable of handling such surface representation. Why is that? For when you are looking at the real world, it is what the 3D representation will really give you much information, whereas when you are looking at just maps, it can just give you some thematic information which can give you some details. But if you are representing any detail in a 3D map, that gives you an accurate information, and it is visibly important for any person to understand. So, if you have a 3D data, it is much easier to understand, but if you have just an information about what is there on the ground in a terms of a map, it may not be extremely useful, especially when you are trying to give this model to decision makers or planners or any of those kind. So, always try to look at the 3D representation. So, I would request everyone to go back, understand again the digital terrain, digital surface and digital elevation model. I have not discussed the mathematics behind how do you actually represent a digital terrain, or how do you derive a digital terrain or digital elevation model. I would request, if possible, if you guys have some of the resources to study, please try to look at the mathematical part of how do you establish a terrain or a surface or even the elevations. Okay. Let's meet in the next class. Thank you very much.